Well, I mean, the biggest question I have in that letter then, sir, is the fact that it claims that you are saying that Tolly Carr will plead guilty.
That is correct. That's what the letter says, and that's what I conveyed to Dr. Greer. You see, Tolly has the right to plead not guilty and have his guilt or innocence tried before a jury of his peers. He has from the beginning, however, said that he did not want to put the Bakovens through a trial and his family through a trial, and intended to go ahead and waive his right to a jury trial and plead guilty. And that is what we anticipate.
What can you tell us about what other conditions or elements of a plea agreement might be involved here?
I think there are no further elements or conditions of a plea agreement. I think what will happen is that we will stand up the first time this case is put on a docket, and we will plead guilty as charged. That is Tolly's intention at the present time.
Has there been any discussion with the prosecutors in regards to this?
Well, there have been discussions about the discovery, about when we might have a trial date, as far as any discussions about disposition of the case, no discussions. There's no plea agreement. We don't anticipate a plea agreement concerning the sentence. In other words, there is no sentence bargaining.
There's no plea agreement.
And there's no plea bargaining. We're going to go in and plead, as they say, straight up.
Well, in the state of North Carolina, there are mitigating factors, there are aggravating factors when it comes to sentencing.
Yes.
With that in mind, how do you think this agreement or this tentative agreement with the school system could affect the sentencing portion?
Well, the agreement with the school system is I'd call it tangential or peripheral to the fact that we're entering the plea. The truth is that just as Tolly has been planning to plead guilty from the outset, he has been planning, hoping I should say, that when he gets through with his criminal justice sentence, that he will be allowed to be a spokesman and present to the public, and in particular to school-age children, the perils and pitfalls of driving after drinking. Tolly is a humanitarian and a person with a extraordinary social conscience. And if he thinks that he can do anything to prevent what has happened to the Bakovens and what has happened to him by spreading the word, so to speak, that he would do so. And he will do it for the Guilford County Schools, the Forsyth County Schools, any other school district that would like him to speak to the students, any law enforcement agency, or any other church or public safety-minded group that would be interested in hearing Tolly Carr speak firsthand about these issues. They'll have a very ardent, eloquent, and effective speaker.
Why did you reach out to the schools at this particular time with this request?
Well, it is. The fact is that the case is going to be coming up for trial sometime between now and the end of the year. I'm confident of that. It of course gets calendared whenever the prosecutor puts it on the calendar. And this is in anticipation that at some point we'll be in Superior Court before a Superior Court judge. And what I want to do is say to the judge, to the court, to the public, to anybody that wants to listen, that Tolly is ready, willing, and able to do this public speaking. And he will do it if allowed to do it, regardless of whether there's a court implication or not. In other words, if a judge chooses to ignore Dr. Greer's letter, which I intend to present in court, Tolly Carr is going to still want to go to the schools and make the talk. It is, of course, my job as his lawyer to present everything I can favorable to Tolly Carr at his sentencing. And the fact that he is willing to go speak to the school children, the driver's ed classes, and that the superintendent of schools is opening the door for that, I think is significant, and I hope it'll get favorable consideration.
There is some argument that this would be an effort to avoid prison by offering to do community service.
Well, it's an offer to do community service with or without prison. There are no strings attached. You notice there's nothing in the letter that says this is some kind of a deal here. It's not. It is simply Tolly Carr saying, I want to help. I want to serve. I want to do something valuable. I mean, his life and his career are wrecked at the present, and he still hopes, because he is a good person, to do something valuable, to do something important, and to serve his community.
How did the idea come up?
Tolly said, if there's anything I can do to avoid one person following the path of Casey Bockhoven, then I want to do it. And we, as his other lawyer, David Friedman, and I thought that's a good thing. And we have encouraged him in that regard. But he's the one that thought about it. He's the one that came up with it, and he will follow it through. I have no doubt about it. Whether he gets out of jail in the next few months or he gets out of jail in 5 years, when he hits the ground, he's going to be looking for ways to help, ways to serve.
Are there any agreements with any other school districts other than Guilford County?
Well, there are not any other school districts that I've contacted, as I did through Alan Duncan, contacted the Guilford County schools. But anything's possible.
You are not saying, however, that this was done solely for the purpose of aiding those kids who attend the school. There is a hope here with this letter that it may have some impact on the judge's decision.
That's the operative word, hope. There's no agreement. There's no deal. The prosecutors in this case had no part in this. And this is simply it's a hope that when we bring this to the attention of the judge, that Tolly is ready, willing, and able to serve in this capacity, that the judge will consider it. He may accept it, he may reject it, he may ignore it. And I say he, meaning he or she, we don't know who the judge is going to be. But what is important in any sentencing is for the judge to know not only the facts of the incident, and that would be the tragic wreck, but also to know the man that's being sentenced. And Tolly Carr is a man of passion. He's a man of caring. And he would like very much to be influential in the area of stopping people, adults and children, from following the path that he is now on.
So you sent this letter as Tolly's lawyer to Dr. Greer. Does Dr. Greer agree to this then?
Amy, you haven't seen the letter, but the school board the school office has given out this letter to people, anybody that have asked, apparently today. And so...
When did you contact Dr. Greer or Alan Duncan?
I called Alan, let's see, this is the 20th. It was probably a couple of weeks ago.
Did you have a sit-down interview then with he and Dr. Greer, or was it just over the phone?
No, all I did was call Alan.
Okay.
And, you know, lawyers like to talk to lawyers, and it's convenient that Alan is both one of Greensboro's best lawyers and the chairman of the Board of Education.
I just want to clarify here, because you said twice now that you're anticipating a plea of guilty. Is there any reason to believe that could change? Is there something that we're not reading here, understanding?
No. There's nothing that I can anticipate that would change that.
To all charges?
Yes.
What is Carr's employment status with WXII right now?
Tolly has, if I remember correctly, been terminated at WXII. He was on leave for a while, but I think he's no longer on leave. I have not seen anything in writing about that.
So is he fired?
Has been communicated to you by him?
I don't know. This is an impression I have, and I shouldn't even be commenting on it because, as a matter of fact, I guess he is still on leave without pay. I think that was his official status. I have heard nothing else.
So
what leave without pay means exactly is not clear. Those leave without pay and getting fired are not real far apart.
So as you said, there's been no plea arrangements made in terms of sentencing and
no.
Anything like that at this point?
No, we don't anticipate any.
And what is your understanding of when this case might be in court?
Well, my understanding is it will be in court when the prosecutors decide to put it on a calendar. As far as I know, it's not on any calendar right now.
Have y'all had any dates talked about? Are we talking about next month, this month here?
Well, the best way to get the best answer to that, of course, is the person who's going to make that decision. In North Carolina, the prosecutor has 100% of the discretion in when a case is set for trial. And so that's not a matter for the judge. It's not a matter for the defense lawyers. It's a matter for the prosecutors.
So has that been discussed is my question. Are there any dates that you've said, I'm available, are you available, here's what I want to do?
We have said we're available at any time, and we would be happy if we could go ahead and do it in the month of August, but that won't change what we do. It's a scheduling matter for the district attorney. They have a lot of cases they got to keep moving, and it may be that affects when Tolly's case comes up, just the load of cases, the number of people that are in jail pending trial.
Mr. Clifford, the school spokesperson said today that they'd like to have Mr. Carr doing this as early as this fall, which would indicate to us that perhaps this would be in lieu of community service, in lieu of prison. Do you think that's an adequate, fair conclusion to this case if Tolly were to be released and serve community service instead of any further jail time?
Well, I don't want to be commenting on what I think a judge ought to do.
Well, this is why I'm asking what you think is fair.
I think that would be fair. I think anything the judge would do in this case would be fair. You know, when you got somebody with an active mind who wants to get out of jail and do the right thing, do the best he can, it's always an option that the court ought to consider. He is sitting in the Forsyth County Jail with nothing to do except eat three meals a day and sleep. And it's a tremendous waste of his skills and talents, but that's certainly not the determinative factor. What the judge has to do is determine a just punishment in this case. And we want the judge to have all the options available.
The letter indicated that this would be involvement in the driver's education program, but you said school-age children. So are you proposing that he would be talking to children of all ages, not just teens, that are of driving age?
Frank, he would go to any public or private gathering to talk to anybody of any age that anybody thought would benefit.
Would this agree with Guilford County, though, is what I mean? Are we talking about
Guilford County? The letter speaks specifically about the driver's education program in Guilford County schools. So that's what that letter's about. That letter does not limit, however, what else he might be able to do.
Has he made any other arrangements to do other types of community service such as this?
No. No, this is the first. I hope it won't be the last, but we have to go one step at a time.
And with the sentencing, I don't have the exact charges in front of me, but is that option available to a judge to just give him community service with the charges he's facing?
No, that's close, but it's not technically accurate. What he's charged with, he's charged with two felonies. He's charged with the Class E felony of felonious death by motor vehicle. And he's charged with the Class F felony of inflicting serious injury during an alcohol-related accident. Each of those offenses has a sentencing range, or a presumptive sentencing range, a mitigated sentencing range, and an aggravated sentencing range. And those sentences could be whatever sentence the judge gave. It could be either sentence could be an active sentence or what's called an intermediate sentence. An intermediate sentence is a sentence that involves probation with conditions that could include a term of active confinement. Now that's, in the common courthouse parlance, that is a split sentence. And so the court's options would be anywhere from active aggravated range sentences to run consecutive, which would be putting in approximately a 5-year active prison sentence, or to give him an intermediate sentence, which could include confinement in the Forsyth County Jail, which is where he is present. And in the intermediate sentence, there can also be a requirement for community service work, a fine, electronic house arrest, all sorts of, there are many options available to the sentencing judge in the conditions that go with an intermediate sentence.
So there's no minimum under the intermediate that you just described. Is there a minimum of active time involved, or is there
not? No, there's no minimum sentence involved in that.
So community service and time served.
No minimum active sentence.
Community service and time served is certainly not out of the realm of the possibilities that you've just discussed.
Certainly not. No, that's correct.